what we're going to do in the next, I don't know, 45, 50 minutes, I didn't really time this out. I can't really talk to myself like that, so it's sort of a wild card how long this will take. We're going to really talk about what the research is saying about benefits of participation in out-of-school time programs for older youth. What are the research-based factors that make a difference in getting good outcomes? And then a little bit about how emerging city-level out-of-school time systems can support access, quality, and participation. I have intentionally handpicked a subset of studies. There are hundreds of very good studies of out-of-school time programs out there. I'm focusing on 6 or 7 and drilling deep and providing examples from them, and you'll see them on the resource list. And to put in a plug for the Harvard Family Research Project, we do have they have a national online database of hundreds, I think the last time I looked, there are about 500 evaluations in there that are searchable on a number of criteria. So there's access to a lot of evaluation information out there. Again, I only chose a few key studies. I'm going to start with a really simple diagram that's going to get messy really soon. But when I think about the potential of out-of-school time, and let's get some definitions down. When I think of out-of-school time programs and activities, I think of before-school programs, after-school programs, summer programming, arts and library programming, community-based organizations providing programming, sports and clubs, 21st century community learning centers, all the places. So there's a broad umbrella called out-of-school time. And research indicates, the way I've been framing things this way, is that participation in those programs can have the potential to benefit youth, older youth, in a number of ways. They can support healthy lifestyles. I think the critical component of these programs is that they can really support engagement and engagement in learning. And when those two conditions are met, some programs, if you're going after consistent performance and progress in school, you can get it with a well-implemented program. I want to just start by saying I understand not all programs want to get there. And that's fine. That's not the function and purpose of many youth-serving organizations. But ones that are looking at the progress towards school, there's a shot at getting it there. Let's just unpack some of the outcomes from this in terms of healthy lifestyles. I think out-of-school time programs are particularly well-poised to provide a wide variety of activities that promote physical and mental health. These health-related activities are especially important at a time when schools are cutting back their physical ed and sports programs and have few additional resources to support counseling and mental health. Youth who are in good health physically and mentally are better prepared to come to school ready to learn, and so are better poised for academic success than their less healthy peers. I think out-of-school time programs targeting youth's health aim to promote physical activity and nutrition and prevent obesity. Programs also often focus on unhealthy behaviors, including drug use, teen pregnancy, and you know all the things they can do. I think that the widely cited statistic is that the peak hours of juvenile crime are between the hours of 3 and 6, and therefore you want kids off the street and in a program. I have 3 now, not teenage, but used to be 3 teenage girls. And the other statistic that really woke me up is that those are also the hours of peak hours for teen sex. So you want kids in a program. Presumably, they're not going to have sex in your program. And that's a good thing for teenagers. I think when you think about specifically what do I mean by these, with healthy behaviors, better food choices, increases in physical activity, avoidance of drug and alcohol use. These are things that are pretty easy to measure, actually, and keep track of in your program. Healthy attitudes and perceptions. So what do I mean by that? Better body image, higher self-confidence and self-esteem, self-efficacy, reduced depression, and certainly health knowledge. What do I know about good nutrition practices? How do I make healthy food choices? And finally, actual improvements in physical health. This is a much tougher nut to crack, but some programs are able to actually reduce BMI, body mass index, and really contribute toward reducing obesity, which is a huge problem in this country. Here's a research spotlight. Again, I said I was only going to focus on a few studies. This is a new study by the Boys and Girls Club of America Triple Play Program, which is for 6 to 18-year-olds, so it includes many older youth, not exclusively. It has 3 components. It has a healthy habits curriculum, so it's teaching about good health practices. It has a sports, fitness, and recreation program. They're getting the kids up and moving. And there is a social recreation to teach and reinforce social and ethical skills. It's gotten very good results. The participants showed better outcomes than the control group. It was a very well-designed study. related to nutrition knowledge, healthy food intake, and time spent engaging in physical activities and exercise. Moving to engagement in learning, which is, I'll give my bias right now, this is what gets me out of bed in the morning. This is what I'm the most interested in my bet is it's what you're the most interested in too, is how we can promote youth engagement. Many researchers and practitioners alike agree that engagement may be the most critical component of participation in out-of-school time programs and learning. There's emerging research on the nature of engagement in out-of-school time, but the school literature actually has some really good information and constructs about engagement. So when I talk about engagement in learning, I talk about behaviors such as persistence, effort, and attention, emotions. So there's the behavioral piece, there's the emotional piece. What am I bringing to it? I'm bringing enthusiasm, interest, pride, and success. Kids are motivated, and there's active cognitive involvement. A research spotlight, again, from a study that was conducted a few years ago. It was a study that conducted by Reed Larson, and I think he has some of the most compelling research on youth engagement that I've seen. He talks about the capacity for initiative to become increasingly more important in the 21st century, but few people have the opportunity to learn it. He defines initiative as the ability to be motivated from within to direct attention and effort toward a challenging goal. He further argues that the typical school day experiences don't really lend themselves to achieving those goals, but it's a combination of participation in arts and sports and clubs, out-of-school time activities that really gives the best results. So he used a methodology called a beeper methodology where he issued kids ages 10 to 15 beepers and randomly beeped them out throughout the day to ask them what their affective states were, and these are his results. When they were in school, young people ages 10 to 15 reported high concentration and challenge, but very low intrinsic motivation. They were really, you know, they might have been struggling, but they weren't really interested in struggling at all. And this pattern increased with age, with 15-year-olds showing even more concentration, less motivation than the 10-year-olds. He then looked at time with peers and other leisure activities. So he beeped them when they were doing something not in school, but not structured. And what he found was very low concentration and challenge, but really high motivation. Whatever they were doing, naughty or otherwise, they were very interested in doing it. But when he saw the structured voluntary activities, such as sports, arts, hobbies, community-based organizations, out-of-school time participation, there was high challenge and concentration and high motivation. It was that particular set of activities that were really getting kids jazzed up and wanting to be there. That to me, I mean, I could go home now. That to me convinces me I don't need any more research. We need out-of-school time programs. What does engagement look like in an out-of-school time program? You know, because you see it every day in the programs you work in. When researchers are looking for engagement, they're looking for active involvement in learning. Kids are actually part of the learning experiences. There are opportunities for leadership, and we're going to really talk a lot more about that in a few minutes. You see engaging and challenging activities, and you see a sense of belonging. Ways researchers have measured this are through improved work habits, attitudes towards school, attitudes towards self and peers, and homework completion. I put homework completion in engagement, and I put attendance in engagement because I think those are markers of an engaged learner. I don't put them in the academic success bucket. I put them in the engagement bucket. Other researchers would put them in a different bucket, but I just wanted to be clear. So my feeling is that when those two conditions are in place, and I think they're really sort of non-negotiable conditions for out-of-school time programs, I think first and foremost out-of-school time programs need to be focusing on the engagement piece. I think many of them do have an opportunity to get kids up and moving. Even if you're not doing a nutrition curriculum, getting kids moving in the afternoon is always a good idea. When those two conditions are in place, I think out-of-school time programs that go after it, and again, not all do, have a shot at getting consistent progress and performance in school. So for older youth, what does this mean? It means getting them and keeping them on a path toward on-time graduation. I think for older youth, this is on-time grade promotion, particularly transitioning from 8th to 9th grade. There's some very powerful research coming out of the Chicago Consortium that is a critical time, and on-time grade promotion is a key predictor of whether kids actually get out of high school. Improve school performance as measured by grades, test scores, and other metrics, and getting kids into and staying on a college track. I was listening to NPR last week, and there was a story coming up, which I didn't listen to, about how college is not for everyone, and I absolutely believe that. But for the kids who want to go to college, I think it's really important to help them get there. And so I think out-of-school time programs have a real shot at doing that. Again, a research spotlight, Citizen Schools, is an apprenticeship model for middle schoolers. It's started in Boston and has some affiliate programs across the country. It has a longitudinal matched comparison evaluation. What does that mean? It happened over a lot of years. That's longitudinal. Matched comparison means they looked at kids in the program and kids who weren't in the program but were similar to the kids in the program. That's in research land, that's a very well-designed study. And they found that participants outperformed their matched comparison peers on most academic measures, including standardized reading and math tests. The phase 4-5 evaluation, which was conducted in 2009, looked at something called the Citizen Schools 8th Grade Academy. So the 8th Grade Academy builds on what happens in the 6th and 7th grade, but understands 8th graders are different. They're 1 foot out of middle school into high school, and they need a different set of experiences. And they focused, so to prepare them for high school, Citizen Schools really focuses on literacy and data skill building. And an emphasis on high school placement and helps kids get firsthand experiences with college. Their results were that former 8th grade academy participants were more likely than, again, their matched non-participants to be on track toward graduation. And the way they measured this was they significantly outperformed non-participants, not only in 9th grade English, but in 10th grade math. So these were having lasting results. Again, this was a program that went after these results and got them. This is where it gets a little bit messy. Do all out-of-school time programs for older youth deliver on these results? No. In fact, many do not, because there are some key factors that make a difference. And this is really where we're going to spend some time now talking. This diagram is still pretty simple, but a little more complicated, because the last diagram I showed you just had the arrow from the activities to the youth benefits. Now we have three boxes pushing on that arrow that help us understand what it really takes to get these outcomes. There's a set of program practices, structural features, and systems features. What do I mean by that? So program practices are what happen at the point of service, what the program offers, the program relationships, staff practices and relationships. Structural features are the elements of programming that relate to how it's organized. Where is it located? How many partners and what kind of partners does it have? What are the policies and procedures in place in the program that can support these youth outcomes? And then what do I mean by an OST system? People define it differently. I'm defining it as support. They can support programs by providing a set of functions aimed to improve access to and participation in quality programming. We're going to talk about each of these three categories now. Related to program practices, when I've gone through all the research, particularly in the past 3 or 4 years, what I've seen is that effective out-of-school time programs provide opportunities for leadership, meet the developmental needs of older youth, exhibit effective group management, and promote supportive relationships. I don't think any of these are new to you, but what I do think is new is that we've been able to drill much deeper on what that looks and feels like and how we can help providers do more of it. Let's start with opportunities for leadership. I was recently part of a team of researchers at Harvard Family Research Project working with public-private ventures to examine program practices that led to improved participation in after-school programs for middle and high school youth. I won't get into the details of our methods except to say that we analyzed survey responses from almost 200 programs in 6 cities nationwide to figure out which of the many practices they exhibited were statistically related to sustained participation, which we defined as participation for at least 12 months or more. I'll be referring to the results of this study throughout the morning. Related to opportunities for leadership, we found that the number of leadership opportunities offered was the strongest single predictor of retention when we took all the other measures out of the equation. So leadership was the number one factor that was getting young people, and this held up for middle and high school. We didn't see differences between the two groups, but for middle and high school youth combined, what we found was leadership was the single most predictor of sustained participation. We also found that there were lots of kinds of leadership opportunities being offered, and I've sort of organized them by internal leadership, what leadership opportunities within the program, and external leadership opportunities. In internal leadership, what we saw was young people leading activities for their peers, having input on program design, participating on youth councils and having decision-making roles, and being paid staff members. When we looked at external leadership, what we saw was young people volunteering in the community and community service. What is also really important about this study, and we found it for many of the measures that were significant, is that programs that were doing leadership well had multiple ways they were offering youth opportunities for leadership. So it wasn't as though leading activities for peers was the number one activity that programs were doing. What we found is that it was a constellation, that programs that were really good at engaging youth in programming had a number of tricks in their back pocket for leadership, for family involvement, for keeping informed about youth, and we'll talk about these other things in a minute, to be able to engage young people. A second major finding that we've in our Harvard Family Research Project study, and also as I look across the research, is that programs that are effective in getting outcomes, sustained participation in getting outcomes, understand adolescence as a unique developmental period. They also understand the difference between middle and high schoolers and are taking a much more nuanced approach to older youth than we've seen previously. When HFRP was first invited by the Wallace Foundation to submit a proposal for the Engaging Older Youth Study, the foundation was interested in engaging, you know, just older youth. And we said, you know, I mean, I'm a developmental researcher. My background is actually in early childhood. I said, you know, I don't think that's such a broad developmental period. We want to test, are there going to be differences between middle and high school youth? Statistically, in any of our findings, actually, we didn't find statistical differences on any of the measures we looked at. But when we interviewed 28 providers in these the cities across the country to determine what they were doing, across the board, they said, we don't view middle school and high school programming as the same. They're very, very different. And we'll talk more about that in a sec. Another study, Chapin Hall, which is a university-based a research firm in Chicago, conducted a study of 99 10th graders in the Chicago public schools to better understand participation in out-of-school time programs. And in that study, youth were asked to rank a list of attributes of programs or activities, and here's what they want. So related to understanding what adolescents need and want. Again, these were 10th graders. In the first tier, they said they wanted novelty and exploration. They wanted new ideas, new challenges, and new people. The second tier of what they wanted was social comfort, safety, respect, and feeling valued. And then the third tier was around leadership and responsibilities, providing opinions and ideas. What this tells me is that adolescents want to be out of their comfort zone. They're willing to sacrifice, you know, sort of emotional safety, tier two, in order to be challenged. And I think that's really important that we don't shy away from pushing kids and really helping them move beyond their comfort zone to try new things. And that according to this research, young people want that. They want to be pushed that way. From that study, they also, youth revealed how a program was offered was just as important, if not more so, than what was offered. So they expressed a real concern for recognizing age differences and being sure that some activities were segregated by age. They wanted freedom from what they described as unnecessary rules, inflexible adults, and strict expectations. They reported that they wanted to be sensitive to developmental differences in a number of ways. They wanted to balance structure and freedom, learning and recreation, safety and opportunity. And they were very articulate about these tensions and how they wanted them to play out. In the HFRP study that I talked about, we looked at, again, we talked to 28 providers. And they all across the board said that, yeah, we're very clear that there are differences between middle and high school youth. They structured their programs accordingly, therefore, and they expected very different levels of attendance from these groups, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Particularly, most notably, is that they did not expect high participation levels of high school students, who had competing demands and had several other things they needed to do. Middle school programs, when we talked about providers, middle school programs, at that age, it's about their peers, right? I mean, they have a very social agenda. So middle school programs that were successful in retaining young people for at least 12 months or more gave youth opportunities to be with friends a lot. Most of the activities were group activities. You seldom would go into a program and see a kid doing something by themselves. They let youth explore within structure and routine. One of the providers talked about it being a tight container around these middle school youth. I was reminded when we were doing this study of Margaret Mahler, who's a developmental psychologist from years ago, has this construct called autonomy with a leash to describe a toddler. And my daughter, when she's now 21, when she was about two, one of her favorite games was called Run and Come Back. And Run and Come Back meant she would run as far away from me as she could, but she knew she could come back and that I would call her back. Training a puppy to do that, which I'm doing now, is a lot harder, but I have my toddler back. But when I think about middle schoolers, it's a run and come back game for them. They want to push the boundaries, but they want to know they're safe. It's a different game for high school students, very different. The other thing providers were very clear about, and it really is starting to align with some of the new research on eighth grade transition, is that eighth graders are not the same as sixth and seventh graders, that they're already thinking about high school, they're worried about where they're going to go. Many of the programs are starting to talk about college, and you need to be thinking differently about your programming for eighth grade youth and prepare them, and that's what the Citizen Schools program was doing, preparing them for that transition into high school and thinking differently about the programming for them. When we think about high school programs, providers were very clear that youth want content-specific programming. They come ready to learn a skill, and you better give it to them or they'll leave. So, and they don't want their time wasted. So they will come one day a week for a good program, no days a week for a poor one. And that one day may be all you're going to get, and that's really actually good. And we had providers saying things like, kids will come across town on New York on a city bus, maybe two city buses, to come to a good program, and they won't go across the street for one that's no good. Young people at this age, high school, obviously they want a lot more responsibility, and rightly so. They're getting prepared in many cases to be leaving school and going off on their own, having jobs, getting married, and it's really important that they have the responsibility skills. Many of the providers in our sample, and I think this is an artifact of an urban sample perhaps, said that many of the young people in their program wanted help on a path after graduation into college. I don't know that that finding would hold up if we talk to more rural programs or programs in other parts of the country. So that's all the leadership and developmental differences piece. We also found, when I look at the research, I see two critical staff practices that, again, many of you are probably implementing, but research is always behind practice, and now we have research to support all the good work you're already doing. In a study called the Study of Quality at the Point of Service, which just means where it's happening in the program, point of service, researchers at HighScope assessed the quality of staff practices and after-school program offerings. Their program sample included observational data for over 500 different boys after-school programs, including boys and girls clubs, 21st century programs, YMCAs, the whole gamut. Their analysis revealed three broad categories of staff pedagogies, so the way staff were teaching, that were present in these program offerings and reported from most to least desirable. So the most desirable kind of staff practices were promoting positive youth development, where staff were providing youth with supportive learning environments, active learning, and opportunities for engagement. No surprises. Staff-centered approaches were when staff were providing a supportive environment for learning and active learning, but they were not providing opportunities for engagement. So they were giving to young people, but they weren't expecting young people to be engaged and give back. The least desirable kind of staff practice in the low-quality programs was where there were few opportunities for engagement, little support for learning. While prior studies have identified structural features of staffing and education and levels of experience, this is a more nuanced understanding of the staffing piece, and I think it's important. Other research has drilled deeper and uncovered two staff practices in particular that are related to outcomes: effective group management and promoting supportive relationships. The term behavior management can have really bad connotations, right? It conjures up images of control, discipline, rules, but given what I just presented about developmental stages and what youth want, it really does make sense that they actually value instructors who can help them succeed in whatever activities they are pursuing, and part of the success lies in the capacity of staff to manage groups. I think that's a real challenge. I used to observe student teachers, and I think one of the hardest parts of teaching for a student teacher was managing the group and the classroom dynamics. I think the skill development and imparting skills for a new teacher is probably the easiest part. It's the group management. I think that holds true in after-school programs as well. In a study of the conditions that lead to youth attendance and engagement in out-of-school time programs, Public-Private Ventures collected surveys from over 400 youth. It's a pretty large study. Ages 11 to 16, so we're the gamut from middle into high school, attending five of the Beacons programs in Philadelphia. And they found that group management was positively and statistically significantly related to youth engagement, perceived learning, enjoyment, and a desire to come to the program. So again, youth were saying, when effective group management is in place, these are the kinds of outcomes we're able to achieve. When youth rated an activity as well managed, they reported getting more out of the activity at each step in the learning process. They enjoyed the activity more, they were more engaged in the day's tasks, and in turn, they perceived that they learned more than in less well-managed tasks. What is effective management? The study looked at effective management and found that it's when staff set very clear ground rules. They can be co-constructed ground rules, but the ground rules are in place before you start an activity. Ongoing positive reinforcement during the activity. Consistency and fairness when rules are broken. If you're going to set rules, follow them. And that's a basic, rule of thumb for child rearing, right? I mean, you don't set a rule you're not willing to implement. Holding the line, so really knowing when to just say no, and awareness of developmental differences. Again, I think the developmental differences piece is a strong thread across many of these studies. The last piece of program features that I want to talk to is supportive relationships. And again, we've heard a lot about supportive relationships, but I think we're finally starting to get some good data on what it means. In the same study I was just talking about group management, the researchers also looked at relationships among staff and youth. And they found that relationships among staff and youth took two forms. They were providing emotional support and instructional support. And in an emotional support category, they observed that staff and youth were, the staff were learning about the youth culture. They were taking the time to figure out what these young people's lives were like. Making time to talk. So yes, you have an activity to do, but we're going to make sure that we have lots of conversation about it while we're doing it. Informal socialization. The programs were not so structured that there wasn't downtime where youth were just hanging out with the adults, having conversations. And finally, keeping informed of youth outside of the program. This last one is actually something that we found in our Engaging Older Youth study as being one of the statistically significant predictors of sustained participation, that the number of ways that staff kept informed of youth outside of the program, and that was everything from going to their events in school to going to coffee shops where youth hang out, and not in a stalker kind of way, but just in a let's go to a different kind of place to hang out. They also were collecting report cards from youth as a way to try to figure out what they were doing in school. So and again, it was the programs that were retaining kids for 12 months or more didn't just have one way they were keeping informed about youth. They had several different tricks for doing that in their back pocket. In terms of instructional support, what this PPV study found is that, again, to get good outcomes, what they were seeing was individualized instruction. So in addition to the group, there was definitely some one-on-one. instructors were very supportive of young people trying new things, even if they didn't think they were going to work, right? Be very supportive of young people's experimentation, and balanced and honest feedback. So there was not always praise. Sometimes there was candid, that didn't go so well. And then unpacking why didn't it go so well and how would you do it better the next time. But there was no false praise in these programs. These staff were telling it like it is and treating young people like the young adults they're becoming to be. That's the program practice piece. Let's talk about the structural features now. When I've looked at the research on structural features, what I've seen is that there are four, again, that seem to be bubbling up. Intentional and varied recruitment strategies, policies and procedures in place at the program to support program quality, a commitment to family engagement, and partnerships. So promising recruitment and retention strategies, I've done a lot of writing and thinking about this, and in our study of older youth, we actually didn't find anything statistically significant related to recruitment or retention in our study. However, again, when we asked providers, what are you doing to get kids to stay in your programs, to get kids into your programs, and then stay, these are some of the things they were saying. And first and foremost, and you know, we all know this, for older youth, getting the word out and using peer ambassadors as well as staff, across the board, providers were saying, if you want older youth to come to your program, they have to get the youth there. You as an adult are not going to do it as successfully as they are. So once you have a good rep in the community, young people will start coming. They were also using their organizational relationships to connect to youth. For the most part, the programs that were getting kids to come and stay in their programs, they might have been standalone programs, but they weren't working in isolation. So they were partnering with mental health providers. They understood what schools were up to. They were working with families. So they had other institutional and organizational connections that they were using to recruit and retain young people. Not surprisingly, they were also offering young people what they wanted. So they understood the developmental differences between middle and high school students, and they were offering them activities they wanted. They were filling gaps in activities and learning. Many young people come to after-school programs because they're not getting what they want during school. They were offering youth a welcoming space and some downtime, and making the program environment distinct from school. That we heard quite clearly by middle and high school, we don't want more school after school. We don't mind learning, you know, having our academic learning supported, but we don't want it to look and feel like school. In terms of policies and procedures, there's a lot on this slide, and we could talk about it for a long time, but what we saw for middle and older youth is flexible attendance policies that take into account the other ways that young people spend their time in school. This is tricky when you're part of a citywide system or any agency that has average daily attendance tied to your funding. Because for old, middle, and particularly high school youth, the average daily attendance, you can't use the same average daily attendance you use for elementary that you'd use for high school. So this, I think, needs to be unpacked more carefully in future research, particularly around systems building, to understand that and really think about the implications, particularly for high school youth, that average daily attendance is going to be maybe 1 or 2 days at the most, and that would be as good as it gets. Oh, I'm sorry. Thanks, Dale. Here we go. Another policy and procedure is a commitment to quality as demonstrated by undergoing regular program quality assessments. I think it's really critical for a program that's working with young people to have some sort of basic quality assessment tool that you're using on a regular basis to look at program quality, discuss it at staff meetings, see where you can do better. And I think that's an important policy and procedure. Another finding, and again, this is from our older youth study, holding regular staff meetings to discuss program-related issues. What do I mean by that? In our older youth study, again, we found there were 5 features that were significantly related to participation. This was another one, and what we saw was that programs that were retaining kids for at least 12 months had staff meetings at least twice a month for 30 minutes where they were discussing program-related issues. We weren't able to ask, you know, what those program-related issues were in the survey, but it is distinct from discussing the logistics of the transportation or the shared janitorial space or whatever, you know, the logistics of a program. So we know, and that has, I think, we went back and forth on whether that was a staff practice or a policy, a structural feature. I think it's a structural feature of a program. So, you know, and it's something you can start doing tomorrow, is building time into your programs for this kind of reflective practice to talk about the program and the kids in it. Another policy and procedure category is easy access to programs. Location matters for some, but not all, older youth. And again, this is partly based on our older youth study. Another predictor of participation for our study, and I think it's an artifact of the study, is that programs that were community-based rather than school-based were better at attracting older youth. I think that that may not hold true if we looked at more rural areas or areas where transportation wasn't so good that kids could get. So the cities in our study were New York, Chicago, Washington, D.C., Providence, Cincinnati, San Francisco, places with really good public transportation systems, and many of those high school systems had school choice. So if kids were already on a bus because they'd gone to school across town, they didn't mind getting on another bus to go to an after-school program, and so we saw a lot of CBOs in the sample. I don't know that that would hold true in other areas. Another policy and procedure is the use of rewards and incentives, and I want to spend some time talking about that a little bit simply because it's fairly controversial. Some programs choose to do it. Some programs feel like, no, there should be intrinsic motivation. We're not going to provide rewards and incentives. Be that as it may, many of the programs in the study we looked at were using rewards and incentives for middle and high schools. There's really no best practice on this. I think it's up to your program and how you want to structure it. Do you reward for participation? Do you provide incentives for making progress? There's a set of questions you need to ask if you're going to go this route. When we looked at what some of the common approaches to incentives were, it was field trips, awards and gift certificates, formal public recognition, jobs, school credit and credit recovery, and financial incentives. So when I say field trips, not everyone in the program was going on a field trip. If you did X, then you got to go on the field trip. So it wasn't field trips were the reward for participation overall, but you had to do something to get these kind of rewards. The school credit and recovery was about 25% of the programs we looked at were using it. I think that percentage would be a lot higher now than it was 2 years ago. Certainly in the Northeast anyway, there are many schools that are after-school programs that have been able to successfully negotiate with school districts to provide school credit in the after-school hours. Another structural feature, and something I've spent a lot of time thinking about, is family engagement. Some common measures of, it's a common measure of program quality. It's mostly researched in the context of programming for younger children, so there's not a lot of research on what family engagement looks like in a middle and high school program. There's recent interest in the role families can play in transitions to high school. There's some interesting work going on by the United Way to look at some demonstrations, some sites that are trying to support transitions to high school. But we know, I mean, families get worried around transitions. So you see a spike in family involvement when kids are transitioning into kindergarten. Again, when you see kids transitioning, if you're not in a K-12 system, elementary to middle school, and we see a real spike in involvement from middle to high school. So how can after-school programs, out-of-school time programs, take advantage of that and engage with families to support those transitions? As with incentives and leadership opportunities, effective programs use multiple strategies for engaging families, and here are some of the ones that in the older youth study we saw. We saw them sending information about program to parents. That's a pretty passive activity. Most programs do it. You have no idea what happens to that information. Inviting programs to program activities, and the set of programs we looked at had really pretty good success in getting families to come. Holding events for parents, holding individual meetings with parents, meeting with family members and parents informally, sending newsletters with community resources. That was a really important one for the middle and high school youth, is to help families connect to other community resources beyond just your program. Getting parent input, and some of the programs we saw were even providing courses for parents as well as for young people. Another structural feature is around partnerships. Out-of-school time partnerships can support academic and social outcomes, access to full day and full year learning experiences, and transition to high school. I think recent education innovations call for a more intentional focus of aligning school and out-of-school time supports, and I think youth can really stand to benefit from these partnerships in a number of ways. Sustained participation in quality after-school programs that have strong connections to schools yield bigger improvements in these particular areas. So I think it's important to have, whether it's partnerships with a school or partnerships with other community-based organizations and partnerships with families, the partnership piece I think is really critical. There's a study underway right now in New York where some researchers are looking at the relationships that Beacon site directors have with each other, with a hypothesis that the more connected the site directors are to each other and using each other as a resource, the stronger the programs will be. Maybe not the better outcomes, because they're not looking at the outcomes piece, but the stronger the capacity of the programs will be. I'm very interested to see the results of that. It's not far enough along yet to be able to talk, but I think so. And that's an example of these Beacon centers not necessarily partnering with schools, but partnering with each other, so using each other as a learning community and support. It's been a lot of information, but there was that other little box in my diagram a while ago that was about out-of-school time systems. The Wallace Foundation has really taken leadership in investing in the development of city-level out-of-school time systems and has begun to harvest the knowledge from those efforts. The research that they have supported has resulted in a framework for 6 action elements that are critical to out-of-school time systems. Committed leadership, which includes top political, school, community, and out-of-school time leaders to secure funding and other resources and shape policy. A public-private coordinating entity that could manage the development of plans, link all the disparate players together, build city attention, ensure that the plans stay on track. Multi-year planning that sets goals and priorities, develops ways to hold and sustain key players and results. Reliable information to document the needs and wishes of parents and children, track participation, and identify underserved neighborhoods. Expand participation to reach more children and ensure that they attend often enough to benefit. And finally, a real commitment to quality, because quality programs are the likeliest, as we've just talked, to get children to come and stay and get the good outcomes. So a few years ago, when the Wallace Foundation had been doing some systems building work for a while, they put some research studies into the field, and again, HFRP successfully got one. And not only were we looking at what program practices were keeping youth, but what were the emerging city supports doing to support youth. So we looked at, on the previous slide, we talked about expand participation as one of the elements. We looked specifically at how our city-level out-of-school time systems supporting expanded participation, access to and participation in programming. What we found was, and again, nothing was statistically significant. This is all based on some qualitative research, which we interviewed about 50 citywide leaders across 6 cities. What we saw was that these supports were possible. I'm not saying that they're making a difference necessarily, but this is what cities said they were doing to support participation. They were engaging in citywide recruitment efforts. So all of the initiatives in the study were directly supporting recruitment through market research, social marketing, and or recruitment fairs. They were also looking beyond some of the traditional methods of recruitment, like flyers and newsletters, to employing technology and social media platforms, because we know that's where middle and high schoolers are spending a lot of their time. They were using Facebook, they were using Twitter, they were using not so much, I think one of them was using MySpace, but is not anymore. New York's Department of Community and Youth Development has a Facebook and Twitter account. We also saw that one of the city supports was simply coordinating and networking the out-of-school time programs across the city. Often as a first step toward coordinating, the city-level initiatives were creating program locators, many of which were available on their website. So they were using these tools to do outreach to families and youth and to better match programs with community needs. A big city support that all of them were doing, although it was a criteria for inclusion in our study, was collecting and using information for an MIS, a management information system. So they were using it to track attendance, participation in the initiatives that were being funded. Some of them are now trying to link these data systems to other larger systems throughout the city. Another role that cities said they were playing is supporting quality, citywide quality improvement efforts through developing a common quality assessment tool, adapting a common quality assessment tool, supporting professional development efforts. It was another major support that cities were providing. There were also two emerging supports, and I don't know if they're emerging because I'm interested in them and looked for them or whether they're actually emerging, but one of them was around the role that city out-of-school time systems could play in supporting family engagement. We saw in some cities that they really were thinking, in addition to how programs can engage with families, what's the role of cities in helping to market and engage with families around out-of-school time. The other emerging support that we saw was around helping out-of-school time systems connect to school and district partnerships. That's an effort not necessarily to replicate or align with a school day, but just to be have an awareness that young people are spending time in these two different environments and how can they be more in sync with each other to support learning and development. I guess finally, just to recap, the headlines that we've just talked about, participation in out-of-school time programs can have many positive benefits. We talked about those. To reap those benefits, certain program and structural features need to be in place. And lastly, we're beginning to understand the potential of city-level out-of-school time systems to support access to and participation in program quality.